I'm Evangelos Terpos from the National Kapodistrian University of Athens School of Medicine, and I would like to thank you for the kind invitation to present the antibody responses to the vaccine against SARS-CoV-2 in patients with hematologic malignancies. These are my disclosures. Patients with hematological malignancies have poor outcome if they are infected by SARS-CoV-2. And this is a meta-analysis of 28 studies involving more than 3,000 patients, where you can see that COVID-19 increased the risk of death in patients with hem malignancies. You can see that 34% of the adult patients and 4% of children with COVID-19 may die if they have hematologic malignancies. And these numbers are greater in adults above the age of 60, which the probability of death goes up to 47%, while patients who receive anti-cancer therapy, 40% of them will die because of COVID-19. You can see that the mortality for patients with who need hospitalization because of COVID-19 is much higher if they have a hematologic malignancy, so it goes up to 39%, compared to controls, which is 20%. And the mortality by age for patients hospitalized with COVID-19 is also increased if the patients have hematological cancer, as you can see here with the red color, compared to otherwise healthy individuals with the blue color. So I think it is obvious that patients with hematologic malignancies have a greater risk for death if they are infected by COVID-19. And not only they have increased risk for a death compared to healthy individuals, but also compared to patients with solid malignancies, as you can see here, because the hematologic cancer is associated with persistent COVID-19. Furthermore, the treatment for the hematology malignancy increases the mortality. And you can see here that if the patients receive anti-cancer therapy or they have received within the last 6 months, the probability of death goes up to 40% compared to 22% for those who do not receive or have not received cancer therapy within the next 6 months. And the intensity of the treatment also increases the probability of death. You can see here that intensive chemotherapy increases the risk of death for hematologic malignancy patients with COVID-19 compared to the non-intensive, to the watch and wait, and everyone else. Another important issue is the anti-CD20 treatment, because MabThera, rituximab, or obinutuzumab is widely used, especially for the treatment of lymphoma. So you can see here that in 111 patients with lymphoma hospitalized because of COVID-19 who had received anti-CD20 treatment within the last 12 months, who have decreased overall survival and prolonged hospitalized stays, you can see that more than 40% of the patients will die if they have received anti-CD20 treatment within the last 12 months before the infection, compared to all the others where the probability of death is only 10%. The International Myeloma Society showed very nicely that patients with multiple myeloma who are infected by SARS-CoV-2 have also increased probability of death, as you can see here, compared to the healthy individuals, which is between 10 to 20%. Patients with myeloma have a probability of death of 26% in the United States, 30% in Spain, 38% in France, and 59% in the United Kingdom. And you can see that the probability of death in these patients is increased with the increased age, while adverse prognostic factors for patients with myeloma and COVID-19, adverse prognostic factors include the stage of the disease, the presence of high-risk cytogenetics, the presence of renal impairment, the active or progressive disease compared to complete response, and the presence of other comorbidities. A Czech registry study confirmed these IMS results, and this was reported in the last International Myeloma Workshop in September in Vienna, where you can see that 21% of patients who are infected by SARS-CoV-2 are going to die because of this disease, while the severity and the hospitalization is very high in the vast majority of these patients. So as we understand, patients with hematologic malignancy have increased risk for death because of COVID-19. And the vaccines that we are using is one of the most important factors in order to prevent COVID-19. So the vaccines that have been licensed are that from the Comirnaty from Pfizer-BioNTech, offering a 90 to 95% of protection. The mRNA vaccine of Moderna also showing 85 to 95% of protection in the different subgroup of healthy individual that has been tested. And the adenovirus vaccines, the AstraZeneca and the Johnson & Johnson vaccines that offer a little bit lower protection between 75 and 90% for the severe infection and death. However, I think that one of the most important issues is how to measure the antibody responses in patients with hematologic malignancies. And here are the FDA-approved commercial kits in February 2021, where you can use that only one can measure neutralizing antibody activity, which is that one of the GenScript. And this is what we have used in the majority of the studies that I'm going to present. The antibody responses after the full vaccination is lower in patients with hematologic malignancy. This is one of the first studies that was published in August, where in 59 patients, you can see that the antibody responses is lower compared to controls and compared to patients with solid tumors. More importantly, you can see that the response here is measured by antibodies against the spike protein of the virus. The antibody responses is higher with the Moderna vaccine, followed by the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine, and followed by the AstraZeneca one. The two first studies, which showed that patients with chronic lymphocytic leukemia and multiple myeloma have lower antibody responses to the full vaccination, were published in Blood, the same issue of Blood. And you can see here, this is the Israeli study, which showed that patients with chronic lymphocytic leukemia compared to healthy control have only 50% of antibody response rate, while in patients with multiple myeloma, this is from our institution, we published that patients with multiple myeloma have much lower response after one dose of the vaccine. While in August, we published in Blood Cancer Journal that patients with multiple myeloma have also lower response rate after full vaccinations compared to healthy individuals. You can see here patients with multiple myeloma before the first dose of the Pfizer vaccine, before the second dose of the vaccine, and 1 month after the full vaccination, and you can see that compared to healthy individuals of similar age and gender, the patients with multiple myeloma produce lower neutralizing antibody titers compared to them. Furthermore, if we compare multiple myeloma patients with MGAS and smoldering myeloma, again here we have the antibody responses. We have the neutralizing antibody against the SARS-CoV-2 before the first dose of the vaccine. Here is before the second dose, and here is 1 month after the full vaccination, where you can see that the MCAS patients have similar responses to the healthy individuals, while the multiple myeloma have lower response rates, even compared to smoldering patients. My colleague Maria Gavriatopoulou published very nicely in British Journal of Hematology. This is an impress paper that patients with multiple myeloma who are infected by SARS-CoV-2 produce higher titers of neutralizing antibodies compared to the those who are immunized against the virus. And I think that this is very important. This is 4 weeks after the COVID-19 diagnosis, and this is 4 weeks after the full vaccinations. As you can see, there are several patients who do not respond, and we wanted to know who are these patients. And we've seen in the multivariate analysis that lymphopenia, as you can see here, and also treatment with either anti-BCMA, all patients with anti-BCMA received belantamab mafodotin, or anti-CD38-based regimen. This vast majority received daratumumab, and we had also some patients who received isatuximab, are adverse prognostic factors in the multivariate analysis, so they are independently adverse prognostic factors for developing neutralizing antibodies after the full vaccinations. And you can see that here. So these are multiple myeloma patients before the first vaccine dose. Here are the patients before the second Pfizer BioNTech vaccine dose. And here are the patients after 1 month post full vaccination, where you can see that those patients who received anti-BCMA or anti-CD38 treatment have much lower responses compared to those who are off treatment or who have received other therapies. You can see, however, there are patients who respond very nicely and those who do not respond, but we were not able to identify who are these patients in order to know exactly when to give the vaccine compared to the treatment with either belamaf or daratumumab or cetuximab. These results have been confirmed by the Mount Sinai study, and here the authors have measured antibodies, IgG antibodies, against the spike protein of the virus and not neutralizing antibodies like we measured. But even in this study, you can see that 20% of patients who receive anti-CD38 containing regimens, 42% of patients who receive anti-BCMA targeted treatment do not develop any antibody responses, compared to very low percentages of patients who are either after with no treatment or receive other active therapy. In the multivariate analysis, the Mount Sinai also confirmed our results that lymphopenia and the treatment with anti-BCMA or anti-CD38 monoclonal antibodies are adverse prognostic features for the development of antibodies against SARS-CoV-2, while also the presence of a response below complete response is another adverse prognostic factor for the development of antibodies against the virus after full vaccination. One very important question is, okay, we have fully vaccinated our patients, they don't develop antibodies against the virus, but how about the cellular immunity? This question was answered, at least for myeloma patients, by this study from Mount Sinai that was presented as an oral presentation in the last International Myeloma Workshop in Vienna in September, where they showed very nicely with the red color that patients who do not develop antibodies against the SARS-CoV-2 shows also very low cellular immunity. And I believe that with this result, we can say that the cellular immunity in this patient is probably diminished. And so these patients have no immune response against the virus. So they are not protective at all. From the same study, you can see that patients with multiple myeloma who had previous COVID-19 and they are immunized, as you can see here, they have very high titers of IgG antibodies against the spike protein that remain high even after 6 months post-therapy, while those with multiple myeloma who are immunized but they had no previous COVID-19 infection, they have high titers that, like in the healthy individuals, we see that we have a rapid reduction, especially after 6 months of therapy. You see also very nicely that for the healthy individuals with previous COVID-19 or no previous COVID-19, the full vaccination produces high titers of antibodies against the spike protein of the virus that remain for 5 months of after the full vaccinations at high levels, while, as you can see here, the myeloma patients have a rapid reduction of these antibody responses. This is a paper from our group in healthy individuals, because one of the major questions is if the antibody titers against the Wuhan virus is the same like in Delta variant, who is now is the dominant variant in all over the world. We don't have data in multiple myeloma. These are the data in healthy individuals that has, this paper has just been accepted this week in American Journal of Hematology. And you can see here the spike RBD IgG antibodies. So it's against the RBD, the receptor binding domain, the receptor binding domain part of the spike protein. And you can see here that the antibodies against the Wuhan virus is almost at the same level with those against the Delta variant for the naive vaccine recipients 3 months after the first dose of the vaccine. If the individual had received the vaccine and had also was COVID-19 convalescent, you can see that the result is again similar. So the result again, the alpha and the delta variant are similar. And the same is for those who are COVID-19 convalescent 2 months post the symptoms without having any vaccination. But how about the neutralizing antibody activity, and especially the 50% neutralizing activity, which is considered the cutoff for protection? You can see here that if we have 50% neutralizing activity for the alpha variant, which is the wild type, is not the same like the delta variant. So the protection for the delta variant is 20 to 30% lower if someone has received the vaccine 3 months after the first dose. But if the patient had COVID-19 and then he was vaccinated, you can see that the neutralizing activity that is the same between the alpha and the delta variant, and similar for those who are COVID-19 convalescent and had not been immunized. This means that the natural immunity against the Wuhan and the Delta variant is similar, while with the immunization, we continue to have protection, but is 20 to 30% lower compared to the initial variant. You can see here that the neutralizing antibody activity of 50% in the against the Wuhan and against the Delta variant have a very good correlation of 0.85. What about the other hematologic malignancies? This is Waldenström macroglobulinemia patients, where you can see that after the full vaccinations, only 50% of the patients will develop neutralizing antibodies, while the other 50% do not. And these are the healthy individuals of similar age and gender. And in the International Myeloma Workshop, this is another study which showed that none of 8 patients who had received rituximab within the 12 months developed antibodies against the virus. We have also measured neutralizing activity after full vaccination, 132 patients with chronic lymphocytic leukemia, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and Hodgkin's lymphoma. And you can see here that the type of treatment, especially if it is rituximab plus BTK or rituximab based, you can see that the majority of the patients do not develop neutralizing antibodies. These are those who develop neutralizing antibodies. And you can see also that compared to the healthy individual, this cohort of patients, almost 50% do not develop any neutralizing antibodies. You can see here that we have a lot of patients who manage to develop antibodies, and these are especially patients with Hodgkin's lymphoma, compared to non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and chronic lymphocytic leukemia, where more than 50% of the patients do not develop neutralizing antibodies. And these are especially patients who are under active treatment, treatment with rituximab in the last 12 months. You can see this is an adverse prognostic factor in the multivariate analysis also, while patients with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and chronic lymphocytic leukemia compared to Hodgkin's lymphoma have a lower probability of developing neutralizing antibodies. As I previously mentioned, the Israeli group showed very nicely that patients with chronic lymphocytic leukemia on treatment produce antibodies against the virus only at the proportion of less than 20%, while those off therapy in relapse have developed antibody responses in at a rate of 37%. And the patients off therapy in remission have the great probability of response with 75%. You can see here that patients on therapy are not able to develop antibodies against the virus. Similar in this study, patients who received autologous transplantation had no difference compared to the others regarding the development of antibodies against SARS-CoV-2 after full vaccination, where those who had received anti-CD38 or as the CD20 antibodies have much lower probability of response after full vaccination, the same with those who receive CAR T therapies. Can a third vaccine dose be protective? We don't know. We have results only from transplant for solid tumors patients, sorry, for solid organs patients. But this is a case report that was presented in the last IMW meeting, where a myeloma patient who had received two doses of the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine had no antibody responses, and 7 months after, she received the Moderna vaccine, managed to have a very high levels of antibody against the virus, suggesting that maybe the third dose may be a possible solution for this patient. So in conclusion, the mortality due to COVID-19 is high in patients with hematologic malignancies under active therapy. Patients with multiple myeloma have lower antibody responses, especially those under immunotherapy or targeted therapies, like anti-CD38 or anti-BCMA-based treatment. Similarly, patients with chronic lymphocytic leukemia and Hodgkin's lymphoma, Waldenström macroglobulinemia, have low neutralizing antibody production while on treatment with anti-CD20 or Bruton kinase inhibitor-based regimen. The T-cell responses seems to be reduced in patients who do not develop antibodies against SARS-CoV-2 after the full vaccination. And the questions for discussion and also for the next studies is, what is the optimal time of immunization of our patients with hem malignancies? What is the best test for measuring antibodies against the SARS-CoV-2, and what is the cutoff of clinical significance? And the most important, what is the solution for non-responders? A third vaccine shot, monthly monoclonal antibodies against the SARS-CoV-2. Is the T-cell immunity in these patients enough to produce immunity against the SARS-CoV-2? Possibly not, but we don't have results for other hem malignancies except of multiple myeloma. And with that, I would like to thank all my colleagues in the Department of Clinical Therapeutics, my mentor Thanos Dimopoulos, and all my other colleagues for the studies that I presented. Yannis Papasotiriou from the Biochemistry Department of Children's Hospital Agia Sophia, and Professor Yannis Tsourgakos from the Biology Department for the collaboration we had for the measurement of neutralizing antibodies. And similarly, the labs of Professor Pavlakis and Professor Ferber from the National Cancer Institute for the results in the different variants that I showed to you, and for the whole collaboration for establishing the methods for measuring the antibodies in Greece. And thank you so much for your attention, and I'm happy to have questions.